Determining sample size. Finding the sample size required to estimate a population proportion. This is the objective and notation. We want to find the sample size required to estimate a population proportion. P is the population proportion, P hat is the sample proportion, N is the number of sample values, E is the margin of error, Z sub alpha over 2 is the critical value. That's the Z score separating an area of alpha over 2 in the right tail of the standard normal distribution. The sample must be a simple random sample of independent sample units. When an estimate p hat is known, we use this formula. When no estimate of p hat is known, we use this formula. Note the only difference between the two formulas is that p hat q hat is replaced by 0.25. Decimal answers are rounded to the next larger whole number, ignoring the normal rules of rounding. If the computed sample size n is not a whole number, round the value of n up to the next larger whole number so the sample size is sufficient instead of being slightly insufficient. For example, if you had 1067.11, you would use 1068 as your sample size to account for the extra part of 1. Notice it does not follow the normal rules of rounding. Here's an example. When the author was conducting research for this chapter, he could find no information about the percentage of adults who make online purchases, yet that information is extremely important to online stores as well as brick and mortar stores. If the author were to conduct his own survey, how many adults must be surveyed in order to be 95% confident that the sample percentage is an error by no more than 3 percentage points? Assume that a recent poll showed that 80% of adults make online purchases, and then assume that no prior information suggesting a possible value of the population proportion exists. So for part A, with a 95% confidence level, we have alpha is 0.05, so the critical value is 1.96. Also, the margin of error is E equals 0.03. That was from the percentage of error, so the sample percentage is an error by no more than 3 percentage points. 3% change to a decimal value is 0.03. The prior survey suggests that p hat is 0.80, so q hat is 0.20. Remember, that's found by subtracting p hat from 1. Because we have an estimated value of p hat, we use this formula and substitute in the values. Z sub alpha over 2, the critical value, is 1.96, that'll be squared, times p hat times q hat divided by the standard margin of error squared. In this particular case, we end up with an N of 682.951, rounding up to 683. So we must obtain a simple random sample that includes at least 683 adults. Part B indicated there was no prior knowledge of PN or QN. We use the formula 7-3, so P times N or Q times N. We had no prior knowledge of any kind of sample statistics. We're going to substitute instead of P hat Q hat, we're going to use the 0.25 in place of that product, still with the same confidence level, so the critical value is 1.96, still with the same margin of error, 0.03, and then with the calculation, we end up with 1,068. So without any prior knowledge, we would have to have a sample of 1,068 adults. To be 95% confident that our sample percentage is within 3 percentage points of the true percentage for all adults, we should obtain a simple random sample of 1,068 adults if we didn't have prior knowledge. By comparing that result to the sample size of 683 found in Part A, we can see that if we have no knowledge of the prior study, a larger sample is required to achieve the same results as when the value of p hat can be estimated. Here's an example. Find the sample size needed to estimate the percentage of California residents who are left-handed. Use a margin of error of 2 percentage points and use a confidence level of 90%. The first thing we're going to do is assume that p hat and q hat are unknown, And then we're going to assume that based on prior studies, about 10% of Californians are left-handed. And then we're going to answer a follow-up question. How do the results from parts A and B change if the entire U.S. is used instead of California? So we'll take part A first. Find the sample size needed to estimate the percentage of California residents who are left-handed. Use a margin of error of 2 percentage points and use a confidence level of 90%. So I need a formula for the sample size, and I'm going to turn to my formula and charts packet, and I'm going to look on the first page. And on the first page, I see that there are a few formulas that have N equals towards the bottom of the page. There's this one, and this one. Now, I want to find the sample size for a percentage of California residents, so I'm going to look for a sample size formula for a proportion. And I notice that there are two. There's the one that has N equals Z squared times 0.25 over E squared, and then Z squared times P hat Q hat over E squared. So I'm going to select from one of those formulas. Now, I do not know any values for P hat or Q hat, so therefore I'm going to use the formula for the unknown P hat Q hat, which is this one. In order to use this formula, I need to know Z and E. Now remember, Z is out sub alpha over 2. It's the value of the critical value that's associated with 90% confidence with an area in the tail of 0.05. And if I look on my positive Z score chart, I notice it's one of the common confidence levels. Therefore, my critical value is 1.645. So Z sub alpha over 2 is 1.645. E is my margin of error that's given here. It's within 2 percentage points, so 2%, but I need the decimal value, so 0.02. I then plug in those values to find N. N is equal to 1.645 squared times 0.25 divided by 0.02 squared. Using my calculator, I then evaluate to find N. I have 1.645 squared times 0.25, and then I'm going to divide that by 0.02 squared, which is going to give me 1,691.26. So I have a value of 1,691.26556, or 1,692. So I would have to have a sample size of 1,692 subjects in order to be within 2 percentage points for a confidence interval estimate of the percentage of California residents who are left-handed. This is part B of the same problem. Assume that based on prior studies, about 10% of Californians are left-handed. So if I go back to my formulas and charts packet and again look for a sample size formula, it's for percentages or proportion, but this time I have an estimate for P hat. I'm going to use this formula. So I'm going to use N equals Z squared P hat Q hat over E squared. And before I can use the formula, I need to identify the values of Z, P hat, Q hat, and E. Well, we've already established for 90% confidence the Z critical value is 1.645. We're given that P hat is 10%, so this is 0.10. And Q hat is 1 minus P hat, so this is 0.90. And we're still within a margin of error 2 percentage points, so this is 0.02. Plugging those values into the formula, I end up with 1.645 squared times 0.10 times 0.90 and divide that by the margin of error squared. Using my calculator to evaluate the formula to find the value of n, I'm going to take 1.645 and square it, multiply by 0.10 times 0.90 for the numerator, and then divide by 0.02 squared. That's going to give me n is equal to 608.8556, or an n of 609. A lot fewer than if I have no estimated value for p hat. And then the follow-up question is, how do the results from parts A and B change if the entire U.S. is used instead of California? Well, the actual calculations that we conducted would not change. The only thing that we could say is that, with the estimate that we're using for p hat comes from Californians, but the actual value calculations would not change. Let's look at comparing results of two different intervals that were obtained from an example problem. The drug OxyContin, also known as oxycodone, is used to treat pain, but it is dangerous because it's addictive and can be lethal. Data collected from a clinical trial resulted in the following 95% confidence interval estimate of the percentage of OxyContin users who develop nausea. So from the clinical trial, it was determined that between 17.5% and 28.4% of patients develop nausea. Compare these results to this 95% confidence interval for 5 subjects who developed nausea among 45 subjects given a placebo instead of OxyContin. So in this particular case, we have between 2 and 20% of the patients or subjects who develop nausea when they were given a placebo. What do you conclude when you compare the two intervals? Because the two confidence intervals do overlap, it is possible that the OxyContin treatment group and the placebo group have the same rate of nausea. Therefore, nausea does not appear to be an adverse reaction made worse with OxyContin.